welcome to you all. It's great to see so many people. We are actually booked to capacity, which probably means people are going to go on drifting in for a little point. We know when people sign up, it doesn't really mean they're turning up, but it's a great audience. So thank you all for coming. Thank you to Alice for coming. I was just saying to Alice beforehand that last summer I wrote to three people asking them if they'd come and do these conversations. And all three agreed, and it's just fantastic. There's obviously a feeling that having a public conversation is a good thing to do. So we'll see if it really is.
I was going to say as well, Athene, I think it's possibly something to do with you as well, that everybody well, said yes.
Something to do with Churchill. Let's say it's something to do with Churchill. So you've had a fantastic and very public career, but it's not one that I imagine you thought you were going to have when you were 10 or 20. Perhaps by the time you were 30, you began to imagine it. How did you get into what you're doing?
I basically failed to become a surgeon because that was the original plan. So at the age of 11, I decided that I wanted to do medicine. And that made choices very easy for me for, you know, the next 8 or 9 years. I knew what GCSEs I was going to be doing. I knew what A-levels I was going to be doing. Off I went to university to study medicine. And in the middle of my medical degree, I did an anatomy degree and really loved it. And I think that anatomy is a subject that a lot of surgeons-to-be are drawn to, the structure of the human body and the wonderful intricacy of it. But I still thought I'm going to be clinical. And I finished my medical degree, I did my house jobs, and then I did what I thought was going to be a six-month job teaching anatomy at Bristol University before carrying on to do surgery, and then got derailed into academia in a delightful way and left the clinical world behind. So that was the kind of first step away from the original ambition of being a surgeon. And then through my research, which was osteoarchaeology, so old bones basically, I ended up doing a bit of work for Time Team. And then it was literally one thing led to another, and I ended up with a career in broadcast
media.
So
it wasn't premeditated.
Not
at all. You didn't at 11 think, what I want to be when I'm a big girl is to be on the telly.
No. I had no ambition to be on the telly at all. And I think it's always rather disappointing to students that come up to me and say, how do you get into media? And I'm like, I have no idea. But there's a few of us that are academics that are working, particularly for the BBC at the moment. And I say, you know, talking to different people like Helen Chersky and Maggie Adrian Pocock and Jim Akalili, Ian Stewart, none of us set out going, we want to be on television doing this stuff.
And how many people do you think stumbled into television, perhaps in the way you did, but then stumbled out again because actually they weren't good in front of a camera, they couldn't remember their lines, they didn't look photogenic? I mean, is there quite a high fallout rate in that way?
I suppose there is, but with the way that I got into television and then sort of developed in my career in television, I think at any point it could have stopped. And there are so many contingencies and so many elements where it was serendipity that kind of kept things going. And it's quite a fickle business.
Yeah.
So you can imagine it sort of finishing and then never happening again. And I think that happens a lot. Certainly the way I started in television is in a role which a lot of academics fulfil on our television screens now, which I think is absolutely wonderful, and that is the role of the expert contributor. Yeah. That you have expertise in a specific area and you're deploying that expertise, and that is your role on the programme. So when I was working as part of the team on Time Team, I was a human bone expert on the team. So I was there to analyse the bones and actually do all the post-excavation analysis as well as everything that appeared on screen. And, you know, that is, it's probably, I think, an even more important role for academics on television than the presenting role.
But
I think it's nice to have some expert.
But some people look down on that, don't they? You can't be a proper academic and go on the box.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it's fluffy. And it's you definitely stick your head above the parapet when you appear on television. And there are some people in academia still who view it as a a very odd thing to do. And I don't know, it's this kind of idea of the ivory tower, and we kind of shut ourselves in, and we can be intellectual and cerebral within the ivory tower, but we mustn't talk to anybody on the outside. That's never been what I think of academia.
Well, let's come on to the public engagement aspect a bit later on. But I want to go back to something you said about serendipity and the fact that you didn't set out to do this. You were setting out to be a surgeon. Don't you think that's true of most successful people, that they didn't know what they wanted to do? I get really worried by students who think there has to be a right way of going through life, and if they don't know the answers, they're lost.
Yes, and I think, well, we were talking a little bit earlier about young people and young people at school before they even get to university with great anxiety about what it is they're going to do in their careers, even though we know that careers are becoming even more diverse now and you're very unlikely to do the same thing for the whole of your career, your working life. But I think that, that anxiety, turns into this idea that you should be able to map out your future in a very definite way. And that's impossible to do. And to a certain extent, you have to accept that, and you have to accept that you're going to go with the flow, and that you're going to grasp opportunities. I mean, the other thing I say to children when I'm talking to them about this, and to young people who are studying A-levels, that kind of age, is that actually the whole point of a good education is so that you can shift direction if you need to. So the whole point of a good education is that it basically makes you flexible. It fits you out.
And it teaches you how to think.
Flexibility, yeah.
And I think, yes, that people think it's about facts, which is very important when it comes to passing exams. Let's not pretend any otherwise, but actually it's about learning how to think and learning what works for you, to come back to being photogenic. I mean, you don't know until you stand in front of a camera, I would guess, whether you're going to, the camera loves you, as they say in the films, sort of thing. How can you tell? So you just have to try things out.
I think you also don't know if you're going to freeze up completely and you're not going to be able to do it. So I did have a very gentle introduction, though. Time Team was brilliant because I was basically doing what I was doing anyway, which was getting down in the trenches and excavating skeletons and talking about what I was doing. And also, I wasn't talking to a camera. So as an expert contributor, you don't talk to the camera. You're interviewed by one of the presenters on the team. So that would have been Phil Harding or Mick Aston or Tony Robinson or Corinza Lewis. And so you feel that there's an intimacy between you and the person that's talking to you, and the camera kind of just happens to be there. And then it switches when you start presenting and you're actually talking to the camera.
And did that bother you when you started doing that?
Not really. I'd got a few years of teaching under my belt at that point, and I was used to teaching large numbers of students in lecture theatres, but also small numbers as well, which in some ways is more intimidating because you're more on show. And all your flaws and your lack of knowledge is on show as well. And I think I was used to looking people in the eye and having conversations with them, and so I could do the same thing with a television camera. Although I'm always talking to the person behind the camera, not the camera. You can't talk to a camera, it's just an object. I'm talking to the cameraman.
But speaking of someone who doesn't habitually appear on television, like never, if I can avoid it. It seems to me that small group teaching, which we do a lot in Cambridge, a lot of groups of two, three, whatever, as well as the enormous lecture theatre, I can't see that as a parallel at all. Because one, you are talking to the person that's immediately in front of you, and the other, there is this fear that ultimately, maybe desire, that ultimately loads and loads of people will look at you and, as you were saying earlier, find out that you've got a piece of fruit stuck between your teeth or whatever it might be.
I suppose there's two aspects to that, aren't there? One of them is the confidence to know that what you're doing is going to be beamed out to potentially millions of people. But the other thing is, absolutely, you're talking to one person. So when I said I'm talking to the cameraman's standing in for a person.
Right.
And you're not talking to a room full of people. You're talking to one person. That's the important thing about it.
And that was the trick you learnt, or is that what they tell you, or is it just how it worked out?
I think that's just what felt right.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, that's interesting. So let's go back to you as a budding surgeon. And that isn't how it worked out. Do you miss that? Do you regret that?
I do, and then I go, but I really enjoy my career at the moment, and the rest of my life as well. I've got a lovely family, and I've got a really fulfilling career, and I feel very lucky. So I think it's really difficult, isn't it? You kind of go through life going, I could have gone off on that other path, and what would have happened if I'd gone off in that direction? And I suppose I don't have regrets about it, but there's a bit of me that kind of would like to have experienced that, and would like there to, in some kind of J.B. Priestley-esque way, to just slip into a parallel universe and see how I'm getting
sliding
on
doors,
as a surgeon.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, I really enjoyed surgery. I like the practicality of it. I like making things. I'm quite kind of crafty, and I like that aspect of it. You know, it is, by its nature, very hands-on. And when I was a junior doctor, I had the privilege of doing paediatric surgery, so working with a fantastic paediatric consultant in Cardiff. And I was in theatre quite a lot. So I did really enjoy that practical side of it. And then I really enjoyed the stuff on the wards as well. I really enjoyed patients and looking after patients and that intimate connection with people. So I did miss that. I think when I started off teaching, I was doing a lot of small group teaching, and I kind of shifted my pastoral focus that I enjoyed in my clinical work into academia. And I took my pastoral role really seriously when I was at Bristol University. But I think that small group teaching is absolutely essential to be able to do that. Because we've seen at some universities, we've got this idea that you can just give somebody a personal tutor and they'll see that their students once a year and that's enough to look after people, and it's not.
It really worries me. I mean, I watch my own children go to other universities, and sort of the smallest group they ever operated in was 12 or something. And, you know, how can you ever find your voice in a situation like that? If you're timid, you can sit there and never speak, and it's very easy to get away with it. Whereas if you're in a group of two, one of the two doesn't speak, maybe some people in the room who've experienced this, you know, a good supervisor will make damn sure that you can't get away with that for an hour. You've got to contribute.
And also, presumably, the supervisor in that situation will notice if something's wrong.
Absolutely.
They'll be the first person
Absolutely.
To notice.
No, yeah. That's right. And report it so that they can compare notes and see if other people have picked it up, or if it's just you they don't like doing any work for, sort of thing. So that's really important. Now, you were at Bristol, and then you left Bristol.
Yeah.
Not entirely.
I think I'd just run my time at Bristol. I think I'd been there 11 years, and that was probably enough to stay in one university.
That's a very tactful way of putting it. Would you like to qualify that at all?
I was dismayed at various things. So I think that I just got to a point where I thought my job wasn't as much fun as it had been for a number of reasons. One of the reasons was the pressure of teaching, because we'd had staff cuts whilst expanding student numbers, and I didn't like that, so we were losing small group teaching. And I felt that the small group teaching was incredibly important from a pastoral perspective as well as an academic perspective. I also have to say, as a woman, and I had female colleagues around me who experienced the same thing, I had a bit of a crick in my neck from being pushed up against the glass ceiling for a little bit too long.
Yeah.
And I think that happens to a lot of people, male and female, and I think at that point you've just got to go somewhere else, actually.
Yes, yeah. Think laterally, do something else. Mm. How obvious was it that it was because you were a woman? Because, as you say, some men would have been in the same position.
Yeah, it's really tricky, isn't it? Because I think you can kind of fall back to that idea and think, oh, am I kind of excusing myself? Mm. And actually, am I not performing well enough to be promoted at this point in time? But when I looked at the promotion criterion and I looked at what I was doing, and actually what I was doing in my job was quite clearly at a certain grade, which was above the grade I was officially at. And then I tried to find out why I hadn't been promoted, and I was told, well, they couldn't really be clear about it, but you didn't have gravitas. And at which point that just really frustrated me, because I had the expertise and the experience and I was already performing at that level, and then to be told I didn't have gravitas. So I kind of went away thinking that that was a beard or other accoutrements that I didn't possess.
Well, at least you didn't get told what I was essentially told once, that I should go to voice training to lower my voice, because then I would come across better in committee meetings.
Is it getting better, Athene? Is it getting
this
better?
This was told me by someone who was hugely supportive and was trying to be kind. Yes, I didn't take them up on it, so I've still got a high squeaky voice, but, you know. I think people have this vision don't mean to insult anyone in the room, not pointing any fingers, but they have this vision of what a successful academic looks like, and it isn't necessarily you and me.
No, it's not a female, I don't think. A lot of the time.
I mean, it's scary if, we know this one, if you ask small children to draw a scientist, most of the time it's a man with sticking up hair in a white lab coat with a test tube. And not all men look like that either. And it's just depressing the way we have these incredibly strongly inbuilt expectations, stereotypes, whatever. And, you know, you getting out in the box, maybe it makes people think that scientists don't just wear white lab coats all the time. I don't know. Do you think that's...
I hope it does. And I think that... I think it's extremely important to have role models. It's very difficult to test the effect of them, though, isn't it? It's really, you know, because this is something which happens over years, decades of somebody's life, that they're kind of exposed to different cultural mores, I suppose, and they'll have seen lots of different people who represent scientists. And whether you can push in a few of what you believe to be positive stereotypes or positive role models, and whether that has an impact is very, very difficult to measure. You kind of just have to do it hoping that it's going to make a difference. So you have to have more women physicists and engineers prominently on television, that sort of thing. You know, in areas, I think, where we're failing to get enough girls studying a particular subject or following a career in a particular subject, We need to make sure that there are role models there.
Yeah, I mean, the WISE organisation is running this campaign, I think it's something like People Like Me or something, I can't remember the exact phrase, because, again, aimed at quite young girls, probably sort of as they start secondary school, where I think a lot of these issues really blow up, and trying to make people feel, or make the girls feel, that they do belong. And, I mean, it's a challenge we're having in Churchill, trying to attract women to apply to the college, because we're full of engineers and we all know that engineers are male, don't we? So they don't apply. And, you know, it's very hard to counter those messages. I've been having a fairly long-running campaign, which I hope, you know, it is bearing fruit, with the Royal Society, because if you go into the Royal Society, you know, National Academy of Sciences, and they have these wonderful historic portraits, as do many of the older Cambridge colleges, and they're all men in wigs. It's the one in the pith helmet I particularly take exception to. But, you know, and they have tried, so there are now some photographs of women and some line drawings and things, and there's a wonderful picture of Dorothy Hodgkin. But historically, they've got all these fantastic pictures and they want to display them, and they're all male because there were no women fellows of the Royal Society until 1940, whatever it was, 46, 48, can't remember, not that long ago. So
it's a really tricky thing to do. I mean, I think that, you know, we can sort of focus on having more female role models today, and hopefully that kind of offsets some of those more ancient portraits. The other thing I think is really difficult is, particularly with things like physics in school, where I think the last big survey that was done showed that half of our comprehensive schools have no girls studying physics. So in the A-level physics classes, there are no girls. And so I can imagine being a, you know, probably 13, 14-year-old looking at the sixth form and going, can I study physics? I don't think I can.
No, exactly.
And it wouldn't really matter if there was then Helen Chersky or Maggie Adrian-Pocock on television. If there were no girls studying physics in the school, it makes it a really tricky choice,
yes.
I think.
And I think the interaction between the teacher and the class then is absolutely crucial in making it possible. Now, you and I both went to single-sex schools.
Yeah.
And the evidence is that single-sex schools see more. I mean, that statistic is for co-ed schools.
Mm.
And I find that really depressing, the idea that single-sex schools, you know, the belief that it's the girls who don't want to do physics is absolutely belied by the statistic that far more girls go on to do physics in single-sex schools.
Yeah,
but why? Yeah. Is it the boys who put the girls off? Is it the teachers? What are the expectations? And I know the Institute of Physics is trying to do a lot of work around this. It's quite hard to tease out. And again, you can't do a control. You can't take the same girl and put her in two different schools and see what she chooses to do.
And I suspect it's going to be really complex, that it's going to be different in different schools.
And in different girls.
Individuals, because
there have been these various attempts to make subjects like physics and engineering more attractive to girls by pinkifying it, by saying, well, you're going to make... Yeah, I know. I'm sorry, Churchill's colour It's pink and brown.
I was going to say, actually, WISE, so the Women in Science campaign, their website was originally a pinky shade of purple.
Yeah.
I did write to them about that.
Well, ours are, I'm sorry, ours are Churchill, the family, sporting colours. We can't do anything about it, but I must say I'm not convinced it's quite the right message. But some girls will react very positively to that. So there is no way of saying this is the right thing to do for girls, because girls are individual, just as boys are individual. And it's really hard to work out how to get your messaging right. So it just says, we are inclusive, which is really the message you want to put out there.
And do you think that mentoring could have more of an impact in school? If girls were mentored as individuals and encouraged to think about all of the opportunities that are open to you?
Well, I think that's the key thing, just to keep options open. I don't know about mentoring, because if you are assigned a mentor, you may or may not get on with them.
Mm.
And so I approve in principle, but in practice, it doesn't always work. And then you're no better off, conceivably even worse off. So we know that ghastly stereotypes like that. But there's another thing which is always said to put women off progressing in science, which is, oh, how can you have a family and stay in science? So you've managed it. You've done all kinds of things with being pregnant, with breastfeeding, with taking your family along, leaving your family behind. How'd you cope?
I have a stay-at-home husband.
Yes. Choose your husband. That's
as Hannah Fry would say, I have a wife. There was a really interesting piece of work done, the Science and Technology Committee report on women, bit niche, women in science in academia, 3 years ago, I think now.
Yeah.
And there were some brilliant quotes that came out of that, and also some really important recommendations that haven't have just been ignored. They were looking at different aspects of this issue that we have with a lack of women in science at particularly senior levels. Actually, it's not just about science, it's about any career. There were two problems. One was attracting women, girls, into those areas of study and careers in the first place. And that is something that is not a problem anymore for biology and medicine, but is a massive problem for the hard sciences,
yes,
as they're so-called.
Yes,
the physical sciences, physics and engineering, which obviously are harder than biology.
or English or French.
It's mad, isn't it? Absolutely crazy. So there's obviously an image problem, there's a problem with the way that those subjects are viewed and what girls think they're capable of or what's fitting for a girl to do. So that's one issue. But the other issue is the whole leaky pipeline thing.
Yes.
And it does exist. And we know that, as you go throughout careers, you just see fewer and fewer women in those careers. What we don't know is where the women are going, so we haven't done enough work looking at that. And it may well be that they're going off into careers where they're using their science. And so they might be going off into things like teaching, where we need to have teachers with good science backgrounds. So we need to do a bit more work on that to really understand what's happening. The pipeline is leaking, but we don't know where it's leaking into. On the other hand, it does seem to be a big problem with retention. And I think the fact it happens when women are in their 30s gives you, sort of late 20s, 30s, gives you a big clue about what's
actually
happening.
But you say that, but Murray Edwards did a study of a lot of their alumni a year or two back, and they showed that the coping with their family wasn't what drove them out, it was coping with their colleagues. Sorry, I said that at the wrong moment. And the atmosphere at work, possibly because they became Karens, and the sort of attitudes was what drove them out, rather than actually just coping with the... And the kind of thing you were talking about, your lack of gravitas, I mean, that kind of thing is enough to poison an atmosphere, as you've kind of indicated. And so there are lots of reasons, and it's kind of simplistic, I think, to say it's childbearing per se. It's the whole thing. And yes, you and I are both examples of women who've survive that terrible thing of having children. And it can be done. I should say, I was saying to Alice earlier that I had a PhD student of mine who looked me in the face and said, well, I'm not going to stay in academia, a female student, I'm not going to stay in academia because it's impossible to be an academic scientist and have a family. And I looked at her and said, how can you say that to me? And she didn't answer. I mean, it obviously, she just hadn't made the connection. Maybe she didn't think I was a woman, I don't know. it was just really bizarre. But I think there is that kind of fear. But you really have. I mean, you've filmed when you're pregnant in far-flung parts of the world. You've taken your baby along and fed on whatever the word is, on site, whatever.
Yeah. No, I was I took my daughter along whilst filming Digging for Britain, which was actually all UK based, but involved some flying around and a lot of travelling. And that was when she was just 5 weeks old. And I was absolutely determined that I was going to...
How much sleep had you had?
Not much. I was absolutely determined I was going to feed her, and she was going to get breast milk for 6 months as well. So there were a couple of things that had to happen. My lovely husband had to come with me, and he had to be looking after my baby whilst I was actually filming. We had to try and time lunchtime so it would work for her as well as me. But she had to be bottle feeding too, so I was expressing milk as well. And so the crew got very used to me kind of disappearing underneath a big shawl and pumping breast milk. So glamorous, isn't it? And I was really militant about it as well. I was kind of waiting for somebody to challenge me about breastfeeding my baby. I was quite discreet, but militant. And nobody challenged me. Maybe I looked like I was ready for a fight. I was ready for a fight.
No, they probably just thought, oh, she'll be hormonal. We don't want to go there.
But it was amazing how well it worked, actually. I think it was a big risk for the production company to take. Mm. So I'd basically signed up for the job, as it were, and then told the executive producer, John Farron, that I was pregnant. And he said, oh, I'm really sorry, we'll find somebody else then. We'd have loved to have done it with you. And I said, hang on a minute. And actually that involved, I suppose, it wasn't my idea. So it didn't just come to me that I could do this. I had a friend, Miranda Krestovnikov, who'd already done it. And her kids were a couple of years older than mine. And I talked to her about it and she said, you can do it. And she took her mum with her when she was filming, and took her babies with her and was feeding them, and it all worked. So I said to John, look, it could work. So my husband will come with me. My baby will come with me. We're not going to do more than 10-hour days. So this is unusual in the media. So it's usually 12 hours at least. 12 hours is meant to be the maximum, but as far as a production manager is concerned, that's their minimum. So I was like, I'm not doing more than 10-hour days, and we're not leaving a hotel before 8 o'clock in the morning, and we're not getting to a hotel after 8 o'clock at night, and these are my conditions, and an hour lunch break. And they were like, okay, we'll try it. And the executive producer, John Farron, was wonderful, and he said, if it doesn't work, because you don't know if it's going to work, if it doesn't work, then we can bring in a second presenter, or you can leave... You can leave the show. So that was really important because it meant I didn't have this kind of massive pressure that this had to work. I could actually deal with it. And it worked, and it worked brilliantly. So this making television can be the most antisocial thing you ever do. It's very long hours, an awful lot of travelling, and then back-to-back travelling and filming and all of that sort of thing. So I'm not saying it's not fun. I love it, but it's not as perhaps glamorous as you think it might be. And you stay in some really grotty places sometimes. So we basically travelled around the country, staying in sticky carpet hotels with my 5-week-old baby. Yeah, well, for 2 months.
And had you already got an established career by then? I can't remember the timing. Because to stand up and say, it can be done, you couldn't do that for your first programme. They wouldn't have, presumably.
No. So I had, I'd already done two big landmark series, I think, by that point. So I'd done Human Journey, which I filmed in 2008, which was my first big landmark, so big budget series on BBC Two, where I was solo presenter of it. And I'd also done Origins of Us. Had Have I done Origins of Us? No, I did Origins of Us later. No, I've done one landmark series.
You've done one.
Series.
But at least they could be sure that you could deliver in peak form, as it were.
Yeah, yeah.
So you were worth taking a punt on. I think if it was your first, you know, show, it would be harder.
It's a shame, though, isn't it? Because it if you've got the support around you.
Yes. But it's about confidence too. Would you have felt you could say that to them? I mean, I think so much comes back to confidence, to saying, I can do this, and believing it in yourself, but saying it in a way that whoever you're saying it to also believes it, that it will work.
Yes, I suppose so. Yeah. I kind of hoped it would work. And it did.
Yeah, you had your fingers crossed behind your back, sure.
Yeah.
Okay. So you mentioned Human Journey. You wrote a book about that. You are now a professor of public engagement part-time. You're doing all this filming. How many hours a day do you work now?
A lot. And I work a lot in the evenings as well, which I've always done. It's one of those tricky things, isn't it, where quite often I'm interviewed by journalists and they kind of saying, what are your hobbies? And I'm like,
hobbies? It's my work. Do you give dinner parties?
Very occasionally. I've got small children, though, so that's kind of, yeah.
Do you iron your clothes?
I mean, no, I don't iron anything.
These are all the questions. Yes. Yes.
But yes, I mean, in terms of sort of free time, I do enjoy walking, and I enjoy travelling around in my camper van, and I enjoy kayaking. So I do have hobbies as well. But actually, reading around within my discipline and thinking about research with colleagues and working on research projects and all of that sort of thing, and writing books, I love it.
It's your hobby.
I'm writing a book at the moment where I'm just discovering these amazing, you know, every day I'm discovering new fantastic stories and little nuggets of beautiful bits of science, which I'm really enjoying weaving together. It's really fun.
Oh, would you like to know what your new book's about?
Yes, it's about domestication of species. So it's I've picked 10, and they sort of range across the world and range through time. But dogs are in there, horses are in there, cattle, wheat, maize, rice.
So this is quite far from your surgeon's background.
It kind of is, although going back to that, I think medicine is a really brilliant foundation for, you know, it gives you a very kind of generalist introduction to science. There is physics in there, which is interesting. I did physics A level, and I think it's interesting that physics isn't required for medicine.
It used to be.
It
used to be. And the number of girls doing physics A level plummeted.
Yeah.
It is well known that is the way to get the number of girls doing physics A level up again, by making it compulsory for medicine. But that doesn't really help the physics degree, does it?
More people might change their minds in the middle of their A-levels and do physics.
Yeah.
But yeah, that was interesting because chemistry is essential, as in an essential demand to get into university if you're going to study medicine. They kind of give or take biology, so it's like chemistry and another science. So you can kind of choose. In the end, I did all three. So I did chemistry, biology and physics and art, because I like art on the side. But yeah, the physics was... It was really important because it meant you actually understood how the heart worked and you understood how blood vessels worked because you'd done fluid dynamics at A level, so it kind of you could then take it a little bit further with hemodynamics. Yeah. So that was all great. So I felt that going back to medicine as a kind of foundational degree, I suppose, for branching out into lots of different areas of science, I found that really useful. And then it has a kind of humanities bit to it as well.
Yes.
So I've kind of ended up. I suppose my own research is more physical anthropology, comparing humans with other primates, that sort of thing. But I'm really interested in how we approach bigger problems and bring together different disciplines to try and answer those questions. So I'm really interested in bringing together archaeology and genetics and evolutionary biology. And then you start to get something fascinating happening there.
Yeah, well, I'm a great believer in the idea that exciting things happen at the interface.
Yeah.
And you bring different ideas, you bring different people together, and hey presto.
We've got some great projects at Birmingham at the moment, where we're throwing together, deliberately throwing together artists and scientists. And that's really good fun. And we're getting some really interesting public engagement projects coming through.
Yeah, we should talk about public engagement, and then I should throw the microphone open to other people. Tell me, why are you such a believer in public engagement? You're a professor of public engagement.
I think it goes, again, it probably goes back to medicine. And the idea that if you are working with a patient to develop a plan for how you're going to manage a particular condition or treat a particular condition, you have to be able to communicate with them so that they can take on a body of knowledge and a body of facts so that they can actually be an active part of the decision making. So that the decision making isn't just something that happens to them. They're actively involved with it. And I think that then when I became an academic, I felt quite strongly that that researchers were the right people to be going out and talking about their own research. So the very first bit of public engagement I did when I was at Bristol was actually a reactionary thing, which was that I had two medical students complain to the dean that I'd mentioned evolution in a medical student lecture without couching it as being
trigger warning.
Just a theory. And so, as well as making sure that I'd written evolution into every single exam question that year, I organised an evening symposium where I went round my faculty and the faculty of biology as well, life sciences, and roped in lots of people whose research in some way interacted with ideas about evolution, and did a kind of public symposium around that. And that was great fun. And then I had a lot of really enthusiastic colleagues who liked going and giving talks to in community venues, but also in schools. And so I was a widening participation officer for my department, which was mostly about schools outreach and raising aspirations in schools and going and talking about science in particular in schools. And what was interesting is that I was kind of doing this because I thought it was a worthwhile thing to do. So I would kind of nip off to primary schools for an afternoon and go and talk about anatomy and take some skeletons to primary schools. And I had to kind of do it without my head of department knowing, because he didn't think it was a good use of my time. It didn't fit into the work allocation models. And I had a few other colleagues who did this as well. And we were all working so hard anyway. It doesn't really matter once you're working 70 hours a week. If you're, you know, going off for a couple of hours to go and talk in a primary school, for goodness sake. Over time, I think more and more people were doing this, and I went to the Widening Participation Office in Bristol and I said, look, there's a whole load of us who really enjoy going out and engaging about our subjects in schools and also in community venues. And I was basically told, well, there's the door. We do this. You don't need to do it. I was like, really? Because you can't, you know, the officers in that department, in that centre, they couldn't talk about anatomy, they couldn't talk about physics, couldn't talk about their disciplines from a position of expertise. They were really kind of just giving careers talks, I think, when they went out into schools. And that required a change of command in the Widening Participation Office, and a woman came into the role, and I went to see her in her second week there, and I said, there's a load of us who love going to give talks in schools. And she said, right, let's do this. And then we developed a programme for my faculty, and then that was really successful, and they rolled it out across the university.
Because Kathy Sykes was there, right?
And Kathy Sykes was there, yes. So she was a fantastic friend and mentor. So I've had, throughout my career, there have been some really influential women who have helped me and have been important mentors, actually. Juliet Rogers, who was a wonderful paleopathologist, unfortunately no longer with us, who introduced me to the world of human bones and the idea that you could actually get a diagnosis out of a pile of dry bones. Who knew? I didn't know as a medic. Well, that's extraordinary. And she enthused me about osteoarchaeology. Kate Robson-Brown, who's still at Bristol, physical anthropology, and is still one of the best teachers I have ever seen. She's brilliant. And Kathy Sykes.
Who was a polymer physicist originally.
Yes, she was.
I first met her during her PhD.
Yeah. Who was utterly, utterly committed to the idea that you could take science out of universities and you could engage with the general public. You know, wonderful ideas about sort of landing in the shopping centre in the middle of Bristol and suddenly popping up and there you were talking about science to a really diverse audience. You didn't even know you were going to be there kind of thing.
Yes, and of course now we've got Soapbox Science, which is doing exactly that. You've presumably haven't done that because you're so well known. It's sort of, you don't need to do that.
I like doing those kind of activities as well. I like doing a real kind of diversity of things. I suppose when I was sort of starting off in public engagement, it wasn't even called public engagement when I started doing it. You know, I was doing, it was all kind of diverse bits and pieces.
It's interesting you called it widening participation originally, because that doesn't mean that now. I mean, the two are very different.
No, it's all very separated. I mean, in universities, any of you who are actually in the university here will know that universities love putting things in boxes and they kind of want you to stay in your box.
Not in Cambridge, surely.
And I kind of find great joy in breaking out and overlapping with other things. So I think there's massive overlaps with schools outreach and widening participation when you're doing any kind of public engagement. Yeah. There's also big overlaps with CPD as well, continuing professional development, which is also an area I've been really interested in for a long time.
For teachers?
No, for anybody working in any professions.
Okay.
And I think for those of us who work in areas of academia which interface with vocational careers, it's actually quite important for us to stay in contact with people as well. So from my perspective, stay in contact with clinicians. So I've done a lot of teaching of surgeons over the years, which I kind of see as public engagement as well, because they're members of the public too. So it all kind of fits together somehow.
And do you see, I mean, you're involved with the Cheltenham Science Festival, aren't you?
Yeah, I have been for years. And that was through Cathy's introduction.
That was through Cathy.
Yeah.
So do you think that that's making a difference, or is it preaching to the converted?
I think it's all about a diverse range of offerings.
Yeah.
And you talked about things like Soapbox Science, and I'm quite interested in those ideas where you kind of pop up somewhere unexpected and you get an unusual audience, and you think about...
I did it, it was pouring with rain.
No.
It wasn't brilliant.
You should give out umbrellas or something.
Yeah.
Science festivals necessarily are going to be full of people who are already interested in science or are being dragged along by a family member because the family member's interested in science. I don't think that doesn't mean they're worthwhile at all. In the same way that I think it's really sad that we don't have as many learning programmes for mature people at university anymore. A lot of those have been shut down.
Yes.
Because it was like, oh, well, they're, you know, full of people who were already turned on to particular subjects and they're all middle class and we don't want to do things for them. It's like, well, that's a bit of a shame, isn't it? But you don't want to make things for people that are already interested. You want to make things for people that are already interested and for people that whose interest you want to grasp. And I think that's true for television too. People go, BBC Four, you know, that's making programmes for a very small number of people who are already interested in these subjects. And we're like, anything wrong with that? I don't think there's anything wrong with that, as long as you're trying to reach more diverse audiences on other platforms. I've lost my thread now. I've gone rambling off.
That's okay. That's
but fine. It is about diversity. So going back to science festivals, I think science festivals are really good, and they also help raise the profile as well, I think, of science in society. But I do quite enjoy doing things at other festivals too. So I've been doing Glastonbury for the last 3 years. The first year I did it, I got invited to speak at the Free University of Glastonbury, and I thought, who the hell is going to traipse up the hill? Because it was in the Crow's Nest, which, if you've been to Glastonbury, is right at the top of the park, and it's miles away from the main events. And I thought, who the hell is going to come and traipse up there and come and sit in a big teepee and listen to me when they could be going to listen to Coldplay? I get no. And a couple of hundred people came traipsing up the hill to come and listen to me. So we've carried on doing that, and that's great fun, and that's a different sort of audience. But I think one of the important things for academics to do when they're thinking about public engagement is who they want to be interacting with and why.
Yes.
And where is the best place to do that?
Yes.
Not just do it in a university because you're expecting people to come into the university to listen to you. Choose your venues carefully.
Because I've been invited to go to Hay this year. So previously I'd done the Hay Philosophy Festival, which was a bit weird, but now I'm going to be part of the Festival of Ideas
theme that the university is running in Hay. But there again, it's still, it's the middle class. It's not the scientists. You know, I can talk to them about Barbie dolls and stereotypes, which is what I'll be doing, but it's not getting to the Glastonbury audience, and that is a very, very different one.
Which is still middle class, though, mostly.
And that's true. They can't afford it otherwise, presumably.
No. So I think we've got to think really seriously about... I think one of the big challenges facing us as universities at the moment is that we are necessarily elite institutions.
Yeah.
But we've got to think about how we can have a positive impact for wider society beyond the bounds
of our campus.
I really
like the model of Cambridge Science Centre House, which is, it has a range of exhibits. So I'm not actually sure where the Cambridge Science Centre physically is because they had to move from Jesus Lane. But they have a series of exhibits they will take to community centres in the Fens, and they will put them there for a week. And I think that's brilliant because that is not the usual subject. You know, if you put them in a shopping centre or whatever, then random people will come and play with whatever it is. And they may or may not take anything away, but at least they're getting... offered it, as it were. And I think that's a brilliant model. And it's not didactic. Yeah. It's much more exploring. And I don't think there's enough of that. But, of course, it costs. And, you know, you've got to get sponsorship for things like that. So
it does cost. But then, on the other hand, universities are publicly funded. Yes. So if we kind of change our idea of what universities are about, and we say they are about
by the time we finish reading the HE bill and TEF and all the rest of it, yes. Maybe on that cynical moment. Note, I should throw it open to questions from the audience. We have a roving mic somewhere. There's one here and there's one diametrically opposite direction. So we'll start with the one at the front and then go to the one at the back.
My name is David Bradshaw and I'm a retired BBC lawyer. And like you, I've changed direction during my life. I was an academic lawyer before that in the University of the West Indies in Barbados. And I've four children, and one of them is a girl, and she is the only girl, and she's a doctor, a medical doctor. you mentioned the exchange you had with your colleagues about why you're not getting promoted and the lack of gravitas retort that you had. Was that before you had your profile on TV or afterwards?
I think it was before, because I left Bristol University in 2009, so basically just after my big landmark series aired. So I was already doing some television, which was very much frowned upon.
Right. Can I have a follow-up?
Yeah.
That's the point that was mentioned at the beginning. Was it frowned upon when you started doing TV in the academic
It was world? It's really tricky, and I think it still is. In academic departments. So one of the things I wanted to do at Birmingham when I started working there 5 years ago, and they had to drag me into Birmingham University, and I was like, I've had it with academia. I don't want to work in a university anymore. I'll be an honorary fellow in a couple of places, and I don't actually want to have an academic position anywhere. But in the end, they persuaded me, because they were all so nice, and I've been there for 5 years, and I still haven't... I'm still in the honeymoon period, so things are really good. But now I've lost my thread.
<It's okay. laughs>
Is that right? So there's a
no.
Question.
What? So no, there was a really important point there.
Was it frowned upon?
Was it frowned upon? Okay. So when I was at Bristol, I think the difficulty there, which I think exists in a lot of universities, and it's one of the things that we need to solve if we believe that public engagement is an important part of academics' roles, is that the university as a whole and people in the higher echelons of the university will think that public engagement is a good thing for numerous reasons, including altruistic, humanitarian ones. On the ground, you often have lots and lots of very enthusiastic people who are very good at public engagement. In the middle, that's where I think a lot of the blocks are. So the kind of middle management of the university, that's where you're going to find people who are putting barriers in the way and putting obstacles in the way of people doing public engagement. And often for very good reasons, because those are the people who are managing departmental budgets, who are actually responsible for managing those workload allocation models. And if something doesn't look like teaching, research or admin, what the hell is it? And should somebody be doing it? So we have to make it easier for those people, to, you know, if we believe that public engagement is a worthwhile thing for academics to be doing, we have to make it easier for those people to understand and facilitate that. At the moment, it's not easy, and I think for heads of department to make it easy for academics to do it.
I think what will change that to some extent is the widening participation argument and what offer is requiring of universities in terms of reaching those difficult parts.
So that
may make quite a difference as that sort of really kicks in.
It needs to be something which is seen as not necessarily detrimental to your career as well. You know, there have been some publications recently which have, where people have said, well, I believe it has been detrimental to my career doing public engagement because it's detracted from other things. And I think for me, the tacit criticism was always, well, if you're doing that, there must be something you're not doing. Even though I was RE returnable, even though I was doing 240 contact hours of teaching a year and getting fantastic feedback, there was this feeling that, well, if you've got time to go and do time team, there must be, what are you not doing?
Yeah. Right, so the question right at the back in the...
Just to pick up on a couple of things that you've said, one relating explicitly, I'm the educational outreach officer at the physics department here in Cambridge. That is my full-time job. There are two studies recently that have happened, one at University College London and one at King's College London. One's called UpMap and one's called Aspires. And they've researched into why or why not students choose to go into the sciences. And they found that the two most influential factors are teachers and parents. Not perhaps a surprise to any of us. But I just wonder, reflecting on the things that you've said about those that are already engaged, engaging, and in particular, given that, talking about schools, in physics, half of the schools do not have a specialist physicist. Mm. How do we actually work with teachers, improve the teacher situation? And the question for you was, what was the most influential factor for you, and why medicine, not physics?
Yeah, that's really tricky. And I was talking to Athene earlier about this because I sort of made up my mind about medicine, I think, because at the age of 11, biology was the most interesting of the sciences to me, although actually I was interested in all of them. And I also wanted to do something which had an application. And I remember talking to my dad about this and him saying, so why didn't you think about, did you ever think about engineering? And I said, no, why would I ever think about engineering? My dad was an engineer. So there's an engineer in the house, and it didn't occur to me as a possibility. And it was, I don't know, it probably was because I didn't know any female engineers or hadn't really considered that that was a potential career for a girl. So I think that, I mean, those studies are really interesting because I think that when we're thinking about role models, we're not just thinking about role models for the children, we're thinking about role models for the parents as well. That, you know, it's sort of... The indirect effect of those role models on the children could be useful too, but in terms of getting more people who are doing well, we need more people doing physics first of all, and then we need more people who are doing who are then going back into teaching. So we have a real dearth of scientists going into primary school teaching as well, and I don't know why that is. And that's a real shame because...
Because they can get paid more elsewhere?
I don't know. Or whether it's just considered that you don't... You know, there isn't much science that needs to be taught at primary school, so it doesn't seem like an obvious thing to do. I don't know why.
No.
And I don't know if there's been much work looking at that, why we don't have enough scientists becoming primary school teachers. Are you going to respond?
There's a bit of a chicken and an egg problem. Because the reverse is true in primary school teachers, that there are a lot of female primary school teachers, but of course there aren't many females doing science, and therefore there's sort of two concatenating effects there, or effects that are brought together there.
Right, so there's a question about two or three rows in front. We'll work down.
Thank you. Hiya. Thank you very much, that's really interesting. Alice, it's from your enthusiasm that comes through the TV screen, it suggests that you have a lot of autonomy and authority when it comes to content in your programmes. And I'm quite interested, how does the process of gaining that autonomy in your TV work, how does it compare to the same process in academia?
That's a really good question, and I've always viewed it as being really similar, actually. And I don't know whether that's just because my brain runs along certain tracks, but I view the challenge of making a decent television programme in the same way that I would view the challenge of a research project, and in particular writing up that research project. So it always feels like you're writing a multi-author paper, and you know, sometimes I'll be the first author, and sometimes I'll be the last author, and sometimes I'll be in the middle somewhere. So it is teamwork, and I'm the one that's on the screen. But the fabric of the programme is a team effort, and you know, there will be, depending on the budget of the programme, there will be a director and producer responsible for that particular programme, and the flow of it, the narrative of it, is very much going to be their vision. There'll be a researcher who's the sort of most junior member of the team, but the one that's across the material more than anybody else. An assistant producer as well, if you're lucky. Sometimes the assistant producer takes on the researcher role as well. And then there's me as an expert presenter. And that's the kind of tight-knit team. And then actually when you're out on location, obviously the team is bigger because you have the cameraman or the camera person and the sound engineer as well. And very often the producer and the camera person, the camera operator, it sounds as though I'm denigrating them, but they'll be working together to create the visual language of the programme, the visual grammar of the programme. And then above, you know, beyond that sort of group of people, there are obviously layers above that. There are executive producers and commissioners who are also influencing the shape of something, who might be like editors in a journal, or people commissioning articles. It is a kind of team effort, and it does. There is that when you're co-authoring a piece of academic work, there's always give and take. You're listening to other people's opinions. You're trying to accommodate everybody's opinions. You then show it to other people and you get the peer review thing, and they go, well, we didn't like this bit, and we didn't like this bit, we quite like this bit. And you kind of get that with the commissioners and the execs as well. So you're getting all these kind of other opinions kind of feeding in, and eventually it all comes together. I see it as a very, very similar kind of way of working.
Right, there's a question right at the front.
And the microphone was right at the back.
Yes,
course.
I know. And then we'll sort of go up the other side.
Hello, Alice. What would you say, out of all of the documentaries or works you've done, of those, which would you say is your favourite, or perhaps the... this may be a bit obvious, sorry. Or perhaps the most important?
Oh, that's really tricky. I don't know if any of them are... important? I don't know. I think they might be important in terms of... Important to me. Okay. That's tricky as well, because the importance to me kind of depends on what other people think of them as well. Is it my favourite one? Oh, I don't know. You see, because some of the programmes and series that I've done take me to extraordinary places and I meet extraordinary people. And I feel as though I'm on some kind of peripatetic conference meeting the very top people in their fields, and that's an incredible privilege to do. So filming things like Origins of Us, which I had a big hand in kind of shaping the whole series as well, and working out the content of the series and how we spread it over three programmes. So that was incredibly intellectually satisfying, as well as travelling to places all over the world to go and film and meeting some really fantastic people. Running on Dan Lieberman's treadmill was a highlight for me. He came up with the idea of endurance running being very important in human evolution. And so having the opportunity to sit down with him for a day and talk to him about that theory was really, really interesting and useful. On the other hand, I've gone out and filmed with indigenous groups of people. In that same series, I filmed with the Hadza, or a particular Hadza group in Tanzania, and that was amazing. Um, so I, I think probably that series is the one which is my favourite. Although, a series I did earlier, which was called Don't Die Young, which is a terrible title. It was two series, in fact, about anatomy and physiology. And I just wanted to make a series which did anatomy and physiology very much in the way we do it in medical school. Because I knew people were interested. Because whenever I talked to anybody about this stuff outside of medical school, they were really interested. So we made it.
I had the fortune of having to learn it all at biology GCSE.
Yeah. So we did sort of organ by organ through the body. And I know that teachers are still using it. And that's, you know, I've got a real soft spot for that series because I loved making it and I loved making my subject, anatomy, accessible to a wide audience. And I really liked the fact. So did you see it at school?
Yes, I saw it.
Oh, that's fantastic. You see, so that, maybe that's got to be my favourite.
Important. Important. Yeah. Has impact. Right, there's one here.
I've spent 50 years as being both a journalist and an academic in parallel, and I found that many of my academic colleagues regarded me as less of a scholar for writing for the national press. But my question for you is, with this unfortunate new habit of no-platforming people, how would you deal with a proposal that you be no-platformed if your views were deemed to be controversial?
I'd probably make a video and stick it on YouTube. And platform myself. Yeah.
Nice succinct answer. Right.
In fact.
But I think, I mean, that's fascinating, isn't it? That it's considered that you're writing for a bigger audience and therefore necessarily there's something less meaty about that, and I hate that. I mean, my absolute hero of science writing is Stephen Jay Gould, who can be very dense at times, actually, and he does go off using very strange metaphors about baseball, which leave me cold. But most of the time, his writing's absolutely beautiful and illuminating. And when he writes about science writing, he says it's not about dumbing down, and it's about exploring the complexity of theory, but without using all the jargon. And I think that, you know, when you're writing for a broad audience, that's what you're doing. And it also means you know your subject really well if you can do that. It's the same as teaching, isn't it?
Yes.
If you can teach something to first-year undergraduates, you have to know it very, very well. And you have to know it well enough to be able to anticipate questions. And you find holes in your knowledge that you didn't even know were there when you start trying to simplify it, but without dumbing down.
Well, Gould was a highly original scholar, but what it does is it conjures up the old aphorism about jack of all trades, master of none.
Yeah, that's sad, isn't it? Or he was a polymath. Yeah.
Yes. Polymath sounds much better. Right, the woman in the middle with black jumper.
Thank you very much. I really enjoyed this talk, really illuminating. As somebody who stepped away from being a chemist a few years ago, I was actually at the University of Birmingham, and whilst I was there, I did start interpreting people's research as an art. It was a kernel of a project that I started to do, and it married my two loves of art and illustration and painting and the science that I loved and still love today. And my question for you is, I mean, my friend here said that I should come along to hear you talk today, and she wondered perhaps it would reignite that desire to carry on with that project. And it's fair to say, I think it has. And I really would like to get back into being a part of that science community, particularly through interpreting people's research as art. I think it's an important thing that we do, sharing the science that happens, not just through journals and in circles where you know, only the literate can understand what's being done, but in a very visual way that everyone can at least have their interest sparked. So my question to you after that long detour there is, if you had one piece of advice for me and anyone else in the audience who is interested in engagement and outreach and connecting their perhaps abandoned loves of science again with what they're doing, what would that be? What would your bit of advice, in as much as you can give it, be?
I think beyond just do it, and, you know, go and find people to work with. I think collaboration is probably the key to it. And as I've already mentioned, you know, some of the projects we're doing at Birmingham, where we're throwing together, deliberately throwing together scientists and artists, and finding people who are sort of open to working in ways like that, I think can be really exciting. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, do you have collaborators already? Do you know people that you can work with? I think it's very difficult if you're on your own. Mm. I think one of the things you need to do is, if you're working in that kind of area, is to work with other people and to develop ideas. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think, you know, there was a fantastic start of the week this week where they were talking about play and creativity. I don't know if you caught it.
No.
The ex-cricketer, Ed Smith, came back with a fantastic quote in the middle of that program, the whole program is worth a listen to, actually. They were talking about fun palaces where you're trying to bring together artists and scientists, and it's a community-driven venture. But they were also talking about serendipity and saying we don't really have places where we create opportunity for serendipity. And Ed Smith, bless him, came back and said, I think we do have places that curate serendipity, and those places are universities. Mm. So I think if you can get your foot in the door and find serendipitous meetings with like-minded people from other disciplines,
mm-hmm. Yes,
then
maybe
that should get you started.
Do you want to pass the mic to the person next to you?
I love that, though. Universities curate serendipity.
Yeah, well, we'll be happy with that.
Do you think to be successful on television in the modern world, you need to have a lack of gravitas?
I don't know. I think we can deal with diversity. I think we can have people who don't have whatever gravitas is. I'm still not really sure I know what it is. But I think we need diversity. I think we need a lot of different people from a lot of different backgrounds. You know, male and female, different sexualities, different ethnicities. We cannot retreat to just having one or two people who are sort of covering everything. We need to have a really good range of people. And also we need to hear from real researchers. I mean, I really believe this. And we need to... One of the things I find most fulfilling about the sort of programme making I'm doing is that I like giving... and it sounds really paternalistic. I don't mean it to sound paternalistic. I want to give researchers their own voice. So, you know, sometimes there are too many people in a programme and you have to kind of summarise somebody's research. If you can name check them, that's great. But it's even better to go and interview them and to listen to their own story and also to tap into their passion and their enthusiasm for their subject. So we need to hear from real researchers. And similarly, any kind of public engagement at university, it needs to be the actual researchers and teachers who are going out and doing it.
I've got the mic. Hi. I have to say, I'm sorry I kind of ruined your diversity. I was one of the people that traipsed up the hill to see you talk about Celts this year at Glastonbury. But I am a Cambridge archaeology grad student, so I kind of ruined it for you. Sorry. But my question to you is about, it's kind of what you were talking about just now, about books. So obviously academics write a lot of research and articles aimed at a specific audience. You also write books aimed at a wider audience. How do you write that, get a slightly different mindset to be able to talk to people that know the field, but also people that don't as much? And how do you do that in a way that's not just passed off as fluff, as you would sit the same kind of way in TV that you get done in that kind of word? How do you bridge that gap, and how do you specifically change your way of writing?
I think, I don't know, I suppose I think I've got an internal barometer. I'm not quite sure who set it, and it probably moves around a bit. But I've got an internal barometer of an acceptable level. And I think that, going back to Stephen Jay Gould, I mean, I really believe what he said, which is that you do not have to dumb down the concepts, and that actually the real trick is if you can explain the concept to somebody who doesn't have the technical language. And you know, that's the same for any teaching, isn't it? That's, you know, that's the challenge of teaching and the joy of teaching all the way through. Because there is no joy to be had in giving somebody a pithy quote which actually means nothing, or a metaphor which doesn't actually illuminate the concept that you were talking about. You really want to let people into the secret. You know, so you don't have this black box thing where you can only kind of look at the outside of it and go, isn't it pretty? You can actually let people inside and go, wow, we can see the workings of this now. And that's fantastic. So I think there's a you just have to keep an eye on it. There's a level that feels right, where you can kind of reduce things down to a certain simplicity where the components still build up into a complex pattern, but you haven't lost the meaning of it. I found this a lot when I was teaching embryology. I think that was one of the trickiest things to teach at undergraduate level, because you could miss steps out and suddenly you'd have no idea where you were. And so it's like origami. It's like you suddenly missed out two stages in an origami plan and you've no idea how you've got from one bit to the next. And then you're just telling somebody a series of facts rather than bringing them along and letting them actually into the secret and into the narrative. So I think it's the same. So I think it's the same in television, and it's the same in writing. And in television, there's always... I mean, when I started out, I think, because I'm... And on the presenting side rather than the expert contributing side, when I started out, I always wanted to be putting more content in. And I hadn't really got my head around the idea that actually a programme is not it's not a lecture, and also I've changed my idea about what lectures are as well. Neither are meant to be comprehensive. Both are designed to capture you, to let you into a bit of a secret, but also hopefully stimulate you to maybe go and do some more reading, or at least be interested in this particular area of science that you might have not thought about before. So I have completely changed the way I teach as well because of doing television. And I think I was probably a real thorn in the side, probably am still, but I was probably a real thorn in the side of producers when I started, because I was constantly trying to put more and more content in, and it was too much. And it derailed us from the actual story. And it wasn't that they were trying to dumb down, it's that they were trying to create a narrative with the right ideas and the right facts in the right places, and it didn't need to be a comprehensive, a thesis on a particular subject. That's not what a television programme is. It's a wonderful story that lets you into some of the complexity.
Right, I think probably we should draw things to a close. I hope there are drinks out in the buttery. I am assuming there are drinks out in the buttery, and that sort of go back out and keep going, and you will no doubt hear, smell, all the rest of it. But so you'll have a chance to talk to Alice a bit more in sort of private. But I think we should thank Alice for being so open and so illuminating, to use the word you used, about your life and everything you've managed to do with it. It's fantastic.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much,
Athene. Thank you.